Hello everyone, we are starting this course, Strategies for Sustainable Design. So I welcome you all. So the objectives of this course are to explain the concepts with the design process so that you can understand and you can grasp it and you can utilize it in your projects and studies. Second objective is to give you real life examples so that you can relate. You can relate with the real life and things which are happening by the efforts of several researcher agencies, you know, all around us. And the third one is to give you the state of the art, like a literature and a study material, which is very, very crucial in today's time to understand and move ahead. So the course structure is divided into several sections. So, defining sustainability, what is life cycle analysis, thinking alternatives, okay, taking nature as inspiration, emerging practices, integrating science and design for health of the ecosystem with the several case studies. So, case studies varies from industrial design to architecture, to the city planning. So, there are several types of case studies depending upon the uses of the material and several techniques depending upon the strategies which have been discussed in this course. So we have taken and we have selected some case studies. So before beginning the course, I would like to put up one point. Well, there have been an innumerable number of life forms which have been existing on this planet for millions of years. Well, humans have also been a part of that biosphere, which has been living in this cohabitation along with other species, whether they are animals, birds, reptiles, plants, vegetation, trees, and all of those, even aquatic life, for thousands and lakhs of years at least, whatever our scientific studies give some ideas. So some form of other species of humans, our ancestors of humans, they have been existing on this planet for a very long time. So the question arises, how these cultures of humanity, they have survived for thousands and thousands of years without causing much damage or almost any damage to the ecosystem, to the environment, to this planet. Well, this is an undisputed fact. They have been living in the sync with nature. So in our course, we will try to see how much off track we are living right now, as a civilized society, away from the nature. So if we see impact of science and technology on any place, any one place, any given ecosystem, so it is tremendous. So it is illustrated over there with this a sketch, what is the impact before industrialization, what happened during that industrialization period or imperialism, and what happened in the afterwards. So it is very, very clear and I think evident what has gone wrong. So majorly the period of industrialization, which happened mostly in the European countries at that time, has given the spur of this kind of development which we are part of right now. Almost every country is emulating the same format of growth and development, and planet, you see the apathy of the planet. And it's not just the Africa as illustrated in this sketch. I believe it is every continent, almost every country on this planet is facing the same thing, whether this way or the other, but cause and effects are almost the same everywhere. So about study material being delivered over here, the course intends to give to explain various strategies needed for different stages of design. For example, framing a concept, framing design guidelines, designing itself, and detailing specifications, operations, and disposal of that whatever the artifact is. So yeah, and the idea and the intent behind this course is to provoke you to find and deal with given situations in your daily life, in your daily academic and research life, in your professional life, always. So the course intends to give you that introspection and several ways through which you can devise to deal with it. Well, this course I have prepared with the help of several literature material available from books, research materials, articles, and reports published from respected agencies like United Nations, IPCC and several other. So this content and research material given over here, they belong to the respective copyright owners, and the copyright remains with them only. I'm using this study material here only for the academic purpose. So let's begin with our first actually and the second lecture, which talks about defining sustainability. So if we simply see the dictionary definition of what is sustainability. So sustainable word is an adjective, okay, which defines a kind of maintaining a certain rate, maintaining a certain pace. Okay, so what has gone wrong in the recent times, recent decades, and maybe one or two centuries, okay, that the pace at which the human society's growth and development has depended upon has actually taken a very odd turn. Okay, so there has been a very strong jerk which we have which we are experiencing in the terms of climate change. Okay, so sustainability actually comes right there where there have been a imbalance in the pace, in the growth and development actually observed in this planet. So you are seeing a very famous person belonging to this the whole scientific studies around sustainability. Well, she is Gro Harlem Brundtland. So she has actually presented her thoughts long back in 1987, which was published as a report. So there she mentioned, to make development sustainable, to ensure that it meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of the future generations to meet their own needs. That means we have to preserve the resources, we have to preserve the finite resources of this planet, because this planet is one unit planet. Okay, it is made up of certain amount of some certain substances. Okay, the ratio of the oxygen, the ratio of the other materials, ratio of the everything and everything, okay, has been maintained for a very long time. And I think that is very critical to support the present life form on this planet. So if there is an imbalance being observed in that balance, okay, obviously it's going to have its impact on the biosphere, the ability to sustain life on this planet. So there is another perspective given by D.K. Ching. He says local and external contexts are necessary to consider for building design process, and without which one cannot proceed. So as we can see, it's not just the internal, it's the external, it's the surrounding, okay, it's the all of the contexts, whether they are at present on the site or they are even external, they all matter, because we are all part of one big ecosystem. So everything matters. So here, well, I think this is a very familiar diagram to define sustainability. There are very important and prominent three different aspects, which are environmental, social and economic. Around these three, the whole concept of sustainability is actually evolving at present time. Thus, sustainability is a dynamic concept. So it may be possible that the whole definition of sustainability itself may get revised tomorrow in the times to come, and it may include actually several other aspects also, which we have been observing for a long time, how the scope of this sustainability has evolved in the recent decades. So here if we see in a very in terms of a formula, so here the consumption, okay, should be lesser than the capacity of this planet to regenerate and restore resources. Obviously, it's a simple formula of demand and supply. Well, demand is huge and supply is little. So obviously, we are going to run out of the resources. And there is no factory, there is no other facility available to regenerate those resources artificially. It's not possible. So if we are falling short of the resources of this planet, obviously tomorrow we are going to face a very critical situation. So that is being given over here, that the consumption must always be within the limits of this planet to restore and regenerate combined. For any given a setting of a rural and urban industrial ecology, you can see in this illustration, it talks about there are resources which come from like outside the limits of that settlement. Okay, you can see in this figure over here. Okay, and there is something which goes back also. What is happening as an imbalance today? Okay, what goes as a byproduct? Okay, has become a non-fitting or unfitting actually resource that we generally know as pollution. So cities and any urban settlements, any settlements, they are consuming a lot of resources, and in turn they are generating a lot of like polluting material, okay, polluting substances, okay, in all the like spheres of the like this ecological like a system, whether it is for like air, whether it is for like soil, water, in terms of like noise, even in terms of like a light. So all of these forms are the actually the bad effects of this whole development. So minimal use and maximum recycling of non-renewable resources is the very primary and foremost recommended actually thing to be like taken care of. Otherwise, obviously, as it was like stated, we are going to run out of the resources. So let's have a quick look on the two important parameters of like today's society. The first and foremost, like a human well-being, and the second, the well-being of this ecosystem. So how different countries are actually faring today, I think it is very important to note and observe, because this actually decides the what kind of like a policies, okay, and guidelines and the procedures these countries are going to adapt to make a balance, to establish a balance between these two very important actually aspects. So as we can see over here, the lower part, okay, on the like a y dimension, it talks about like a human well-being. So it starts from zero, it goes up to like 100, and the same for like a ecosystem well-being also. It starts from zero, goes up to like 100. So on this scale, if we see on the y dimension, okay, some countries, they have not even crossed a level of like 20 on the human well-being, which is just 20% of the whole. Okay, so those countries are like it's very evident over here, like Somalia and Afghanistan. So these countries have been doing relatively very bad as compared to the other countries. So on the other hand, if we see on the like a x dimension, okay, so this country Somalia, which is doing very bad on the human well-being, is doing relatively much better on the economic well-being. If you see the countries like India, okay, they are doing fairly poor, but on the sustainability also they are not so good. Countries like if you see like Norway and Sweden, they are doing much better on like a human well-being. Well, they are almost like topping the list of like a human well-being countries. So Japan, Norway, Sweden, Germany, USA and Spain, they are actually qualifying in a group for like having a better like life situations, better conditions for like a survival in their own countries. On the other hand, on the if you see on the economic well-being factor, Sweden is doing better in that group, but Japan and Spain, they are not doing so good. So that means there is a correlation we can see. If there is a like a advanced country who is handling like a human well-being in a much better manner, okay, they are somehow unable to maintain the balance on the ecosystem. So it's a kind of a correlation which we are seeing, which is inversely going. So we will see in the like coming lectures like how this is being done, how what is this procedure, what is this phenomena, how is it happening. Okay, so let me before going on to those details, let me give you some insights about, okay, how to go about like designing, how to go about like manufacturing, how to go about availing any resource and making use of it for our like consumption. So there are two types of like cycles. Okay, for like any product, for like any service, for whatever we are actually sourcing from this entire nature. So there is one way which is very very like a normal, is the extraction of raw material, production, linear cycle, packaging, distribution, use of maintenance and incineration and disposal. So it's a linear way of actually progression. On the other one, you can see, okay, right here, it's a cyclic way of progression in which there is a closed loop. So from wherever we are starting, we are coming back right there and we are starting again. So this is called as like a closed cycle loop. So this is very essential actually for maintaining the replenishment for maintaining the balance. Because in the first one, okay, if as you can see over here, there will be a lot of resources which will be coming for like a as a byproduct, as a permanent waste. So that is very hazardous for the ecosystem, and the certainly it's causing an exhaustion in the already like a limited resources which are available on this planet. So currently in today's like a sustainable like studies, obviously this closed loop cycle is the preferred one where we must close the cycle. We will discuss more in detail in the coming slides. So going back to like a simple like a example of a house. So a house actually consumes energy, it takes like information as well as it utilizes matter. So energy again like a consumed and it comes back to it, matter again goes and comes back to it. But information is one thing which flows like outside. Okay, we take actually cues from the, we take the knowledge from it and we utilize it elsewhere. So we must actually close this cycle except the information part, from where like for example any research, any studies are happening over here, those in today's time are able to utilize elsewhere also. So let's see like how these the game of like resources and this consumption has actually outpaced the supply part. So on this like a x-axis you can see this is a global million square kilometers. Okay, so it talks about like how much like we as a human species have exhausted that actually the capacity of this earth. So in terms of like a capacity of the resources, this we measure in the term of like a biocapacity. So area into bioproductivity. Bioproductivity is a like a capacity which a particular place or a particular region actually produces in a given time. So if we that we multiply by the area, we will get the overall like a biocapacity of that place. So biocapacity is a capacity which is able to with the help of which we are able to get the resources. Okay, resources like minerals, resources like water, resources like soil, earth, okay, vegetation, vegetation based actually, plant based actually supplies, okay, animal based supplies, there are all sorts of like supplies. So combined to them all, we know it as biocapacity. On the top part, if you see over here, okay, so it says like what is the ecological footprint of like our planet right now. So that is there is actually a formula given to understand that population multiplied by consumption per person multiplied by resource use intensity multiplied by resource use inefficiency. So it equals to the ecological footprint of any given place. So currently with the study of like this from year like 2008, okay, it has already overshot the biocapacity by 79 million square kilometers. So that means our one earth today in terms of like this rate of like consumption has already fallen short by these many like square kilometers, which is very very absurd. That means the consumption has already exhausted the pace at which these resources can be supplied by this planet Earth. That means with this rate, one Earth in today's time is not able to meet the requirement of different resources. That means, do we need more number of Earths? Are we going to populate more Earths? Where are those new Earths or extra Earths? We do not have. So how this balance is going to like take place is the actually question, and that is why we are here to discuss like how we can bring back our like rate of this consumption to the normal where it equally matches, or even it should in the ideal conditions it should be lesser always for the like a biocapacity of this planet. So if we bifurcate actually that diagram into like different elements, okay, different like unit things. So carbon is the one thing which has already exhausted this threshold, and it has gone quite high. So you can see it has already crossed this the limit in before like a year of 1971, and currently it is almost nearing the double, because this data belong is till the year of like 2012 only. So I'm sure it has reached almost the twice of the one unit of like equilibrium. Well, some other resources like fish, crops, built-up land, forest products, well, they are in the limit, but there is a significant rise which is being observed even in those. So eventually, if the requirement of resource actually continued with the same pace, I am sure we are going to cross even those. So what are the main environmental issues over here? So if we see in generic terms, there is an issue of like a global warming. There is issue of like pollution. Okay, the pollution, the issues of like various other like natural elements which are the part of this whole like a planet Earth, and they have been the very important actually factors to sustain life in different forms as we can see it in today's time. So that is like a ozone. So ozone depletion is one phenomena which has caused like a severe distress on the species of this planet, like how they are going to survive in the future. And of course the water, different other resources, deforestation, soil degradation, okay, waste, extinction of flora and fauna, and of course the tremendous growth being observed in the population. Population is one very important factor over here, because population is the one important thing which is increasing the demand of every resources. More number of mouths, more number of food is required. More number of bodies, more number of clothing is required. More number of like humans, more number of shelter and housing is required. So obviously, if we multiply with the number of growth of like the people, okay, so the number of resources is also applying like tremendously. And in the recent times, it is being observed like the consumerism has also increased. The per person like a usage of any resource, what it used to be earlier like 50 years ago, has multiplied by manifold in today's time. So the number of increase of the person as well as the number of like a uses of like a resources, so it has, as a resultant, it has grown actually a very fast, rather like exponential growth has happened actually over the time. So these are the actually major environmental issues being observed in today's time. Slowly and steadily, we will discuss more in detail in the coming lectures. So global warming. Global warming is a phenomena which is happening right now in the recent decades, as the average temperature of the Earth itself is rising by few points. So there is always a level has been maintained for like a several like a centuries and thousands of years. Well, there have been a cycle of like a temperatures going up and coming down. Okay, so that happens at the scale of like a million years. So well, that has been the part of this Earth cycle before also, but in the recent times, the span, the rate of the increase of the overall temperature, the global temperature, has risen tremendously, and that is like being deciphered as the which is happening for the first time in this all of these years. So whatever the records which are available from the like ancient times, this phenomena is happening for the first time, like in a very short span of time, the average global temperature is going to rise. Well, there are very catastrophic repercussions to this effect in terms of like it's going to melt the ice caps and snow caps of the Antarctica and Arctica and other Arctic and other like mountain ranges and all that. So as a resultant, the sea level is going to rise, and the moment sea level rises, there will be a catastrophic actually situation arising in the countries which are like low lying, which are right situated next to the seashore level. So resulting into the loss of the lives and loss of the like a place for the like a humanity. So it will create a crisis. Plus it with the increasing temperature, there may be imbalance in the atmospheric like a composition of the like oxygen and the several other gases. So those gases are behaving like a greenhouse effect, and the overall temperature of the Earth is rising. Well, it is creating an imbalance in the like a cycle of the water and cycle of the air. So some places which have been living like a normal life, or they have been receiving like a certain rate at the precipitation, they are experiencing some fluctuation in that. Either there are droughts or either there are floods. So this kind of like imbalances are actually occurring because of this situation. The next one, pollution. So the pollution of like air, water, land, light, you know, there are several types of pollution. So the all of these mostly these industrial like effluents and discharges, they are actually degrading, they are creating an imbalance in the places. As a resultant, several aquatic life, several like aerial life, several like a land based like a lives, those are being lost today because they are losing their habitation. The toxic effluents from the manufacturing units and from like a different other like a facilities, they are coming out in the ecosystem and they are creating a havoc on the species. On the ozone depletion, well, this is somehow like a being has come under control in with a lot of like effort from like a different countries, different like a companies across the world, because they have actually regulated like a CFC like emissions from the electronic and electrical gadgets, home based like gadgets and even industrial gadgets and appliances. So well, this has come under some control. So we can obviously like say like this, if with the consistent actually effort and intent, okay, we can obviously have the corrective measures coming to some results in on our planet Earth. So this actually emphasizes like how important these efforts are, because with the help of these efforts, we can obviously overcome the challenges which this Earth is facing, with the entire like the group of species which our cohabitating like species are also facing. And water, well, 1/3 of globe is covered with the more than 1/3 of the this globe is covered with the like water. And water is an very important actually ingredient to sustain life, whether it is even land-based life. So our bodies are also made up of like a major component of like a water. So water is very important for like everyday life. Water is important for our metabolic activities. Water is very important and critical for the like a climate and weather patterns, like how, for example, like India, like how India depends on the monsoon and the rains which comes in the month of like June, July, August, September. So India actually receives its like a water supplies through the monsoon in these months, and entire almost like 90% of our like agriculture today's like a degree agriculture in the rural areas depends upon actually the monsoon, because obviously we do not have the capacity to dug up the like actually lakes and bring the groundwater on the river. And even though the level of the groundwater has actually decreased significantly in several places, in several states are like facing a huge crunch for like a water supply for our like everyday needs. Well, in the recent years, like last 1 or 2 years, it was observed, you may have of course read this in the news, the city of Chennai faced a severe problem and there was a mini migration observed in the like society. So there was no water supply at all. So people were actually forced to move out of their houses and take shelter elsewhere. So this is a very catastrophic situation which has already started giving us some actually bad effects in our society. Other resources like non-renewable resources such as like hydrocarbons, such as like gases, such as like petroleum products, such as like other like mineral based like products, such as like several like quarries. Okay, so these are present in a very limited like amount. They are not unlimited supplies which we can keep digging and keep actually sourcing. They are going to exhaust one day. So we must take care of the supply of these resources so that we can keep taking them even for tomorrow. Because if it is going to exhaust in like a coming few years, there won't be any more new mineral available or there won't be any new hydrocarbon available for like consumption. So how the human society is going to sustain in those times is a big question. Deforestation, well, obviously everybody knows, even a child knows, like trees are very important for the oxygen supply to maintain a balance of like oxygen in our atmosphere on this planet. So with this current rate of like a deforestation, like a cutting of trees, okay, this oxygen supply is directly going to be affected. Okay, and where are we going to get that oxygen from? There is no like a facility to produce oxygen at this global level. Well, we can produce oxygen, okay, for one cylinder, two cylinder, but we cannot produce oxygen at this level. Okay, we cannot actually replenish oxygen, the supply of oxygen artificially for this entire planet. Well, that's not feasible, that's not possible, that's not practical. So we must actually take care of these trees, because these trees are very important to maintain actually life, not just for humans, for like every living being. Soil degradation. Soil is very important. We are standing all our works all our things, all our buildings, all our structures, all our like transportation, everything is happening on the actually at top of this soil. So the soil is very important ingredient first of all to give us food, because on in this soil only we grow our like crops and other like vegetables, other fruits and everything. Okay, so we are very much dependent on this soil, and we must not degrade it, because this is not going to give the desired yield in terms of like agricultural produce. And the waste, well, there are like a huge amount of like a waste being generated these days. Okay, cities, you may have seen like artificial like mounds which are coming up, artificial hills which are coming up in the cities on the outskirts of the cities, and there are low-lying areas which are just being filled with the huge amount of trash. They are as good as high as a small like hillock or maybe a hill. So this is the condition. If you go to like a New Delhi, there are three major actually landfill sites which have come up in the like a recent decades on the outskirts of like a city of like a Delhi and New Delhi, which is very very bad, because if you cross from that area, so they actually have created a very bad atmosphere for a good comfortable living over there. They create a lot of like poisonous gases, you know, poisonous like substances. Okay, the concentration of actually different elements and compounds which are hazardous in nature, which cannot be actually decomposed, which cannot be actually degraded in a short span of time, they have all been gathered at one place for in a very high actually concentration, so which is very bad. So we must actually take care of like a waste. So the first and foremost actually way is to minimize the amount of waste itself, and then the second could be recycling and reusing it. So we will go through these strategies in the coming lecture, like how we can take care of the waste generation. Okay, the second last one is extinction of flora and fauna. So all of this post-industrialized actually era like effects, there have been quite a much impact on the different like living species of this planet, like birds, you know, animals, reptiles, you know, aquatic animals. And as a resultant of like a toxic chemicals and imbalance in the like a temperature, imbalance in the like a climate and overall like a weather pattern, okay, they are actually facing a very difficult situation for their survival. So their new beings, their eggs, you know, their newborn actually babies, they are unable to survive in such an inhospitable actually situation. As a resultant, they are losing significantly their population, and several of the species in front of our this human society in the last 150 years, they have actually kind of vanished from this planet for forever, which is very very unfortunate. Like how this one species, like us humans, Homo sapiens, are causing such a catastrophic situation to create imbalance on their planet, and as at all several other species who are equally deserving for this to live on this planet, they are losing their lives, they are losing their entire species to this kind of effect. Well, of course, as I emphasized earlier, population is one thing which is creating like a such kind of demand. So population is the first and foremost culprit thing which comes under the sustainable studies, and so the how population can be controlled, and as a resultant, every like consumption, every like a need of the resources, every requirement of resources can be controlled. So let me give you some figures, like the number of middle class consumers. Okay, so it is being expected it is going to triple by year 2030. So as you can see on this graph on the right hand side, the overall the number of the people with income range between $6,000 to $30,000 is around 3,500. Okay, and this is in the millions of the people. And if you see there are two big countries, well, of course our own country like India and China, which are the major actually contributors for the percentage of population at the global level. So we India stands somewhere close to 1,500, China somewhere stands around 2,000, and the rest of the world minus India and China stands somewhere around 2,500, and the entire world as a one unit stands somewhere around 3,500. So there is a projection, if you see the coming years, okay, this percentage is going to will decrease with a lot of like a effort being made from like a government and governmental agencies, okay, our health sector, okay, to control the population, to bring the population at a check, where the number of population, which is the number of people who are being born, okay, every year, should come to the closer of the number of people who are dying like every year. So a static rate of growth can be maintained in terms of population. So this is very important, because as the number of consumers, as the number of like mouths are rising, well, the number of the amount of food required will also have to rise. But the question is, with the limited number of resources, whether it is possible. So let's see, like this actually chart shows the relative estimated value of like a low income market sectors. The total consumer expenditure in these sectors equals $5 trillion. The size of each segment on the graph reflects its share of expenditure among low income consumers. So in this one, if you see, food is the first and the foremost item, which is like a taking the huge space. I think more than 50% is taken only by food. Well, of course, the number of like a people are rising, and the basic requirement is to feed them. So, and after that, there is like housing, the need of energy. Okay, so the per person consumption of energy has also risen significantly in the recent decades. So almost like every electrical, electronic gadget and every kind of like appliance, even with this computer on which we are actually making this video and we are reading and learning this, okay, is also consuming a lot of power. So the reliance of the human society in today's time has significantly risen for the like a need of the energy. So each and every exploration, whatever we are doing today, requires energy. Whether it is like electrical energy, so mostly it is electrical energy, which we derive from the like a coal, which we derive from like a oil, which we derive from like a wind power, solar power, okay, nuclear plants, okay, hydro plants. So there are several ways we are actually harvesting this energy, and we are trying to meet our demand. But still, world is not able to fulfill the entire the electricity demand of it. So this energy sector has actually risen tremendously in the recent decades. It is very important to address actually the requirement of the energy which is needed for our like survival. The next has like a transportation. So as the globalization has happened over the time, over the like India started globalizing its economy since like 1991. Okay, and since then until today, and I think the future is going to, the future which is going to come. Okay. The movement, okay, the global movement of people, goods, you know, everything has risen like tremendously. Earlier, generally, like whatever was produced in a country was consumed also within the limits of that country. There was very little actually exchanged from the like outside world. But in today's time, this world is reduced in a global village. Okay, and now there is a lot of like transportation. So this transportation also exerts a lot of like a problem directly and indirectly on this ecosystem. So now, instead of like a going for like any such time, the smaller requirements like for like touring or in a day out for like 2-3 days or a week or something, instead of going nearby, we are now on disposal to go anywhere on the like a global scale. So this is actually increasing a lot of like transportation. Now we are sourcing, actually we are buying stuff internationally. So as you may be aware of, like China has in today's times have become like a global factory. So China is supplying a lot of material, a lot of like a finished material for like almost every country on this planet. So the meeting the requirements is one thing. On the other hand, if you see, this exerts a lot of pressure also. So how this can be maintained, you can see on the table on the right side over here. The population of Asia, okay, including like the Middle East, around 2.86 billion, okay, and market size of the low income segment is around $3.47 trillion, okay. So, and percentage of the region's population in this actually sector is around 83%, okay, and percentage of the region's like a purchasing power overall is like only 42%. So actually these charts actually give us this like a picture of how this low income consumers, okay, they are actually accounting for the consumption of the resources, okay, in the like continents, in the subcontinents, and at the global level. Okay, so in this slide I would like to talk about like the effects of the development, which we discussed in one of the like a previous slides, like the human development index, okay, like a human well-being and those kind of like a thing. So there is a unit between like a 0 to 1. Okay, and on the Y dimension, we have actually the ecological footprint of the like a humanity at the like a global level. So this is given in like a global hectares per person, and this data is from year 2003 only. So I'm sure there is a lot actually has changed in the recent years, because every new decade, okay, we are experiencing tremendous growth, okay, from the previous decades in terms of like the sharp incline in the like our whether it is like a global footprint, or that it is like a consumption, either the consumption of like resources or even increase of the population, several actually factors. So here, as you can see, there is a dotted line right here, which talks about this line actually denotes world's average biocapacity available per person. So this is this biocapacity little below of like a 2. Okay, this is like an average biocapacity which this earth offers without harming the threshold of it, without harming the overall balance of this planet Earth. So there are a lot number of like countries in this region, okay, from here to here, you can see, which are still within this limit. Mostly these are the countries in this yellow circles. They are from like Africa. So the countries mostly from like an African continent, okay, they are well within the reach of ecological footprint, okay, as a country. Well, except one or two who have actually gone above this line. So in this one, actually, if you slide, if you see, as we discussed in the previous earlier slide, the pace at which the human well-being is being taken care of, and the pace at which the ecological footprint or the ecological balance is being taken care of, is going like inversely proportional. And that is evident even here. So mostly these the countries from like Africa, well, we generally know like most of these African countries, they are not doing so good on like economic terms, okay, they are lagging behind. Even there are some countries who are faring very bad on like even being able to feed the citizens, the people of their country. So as a group of like country, if we see as a continent, Africa is far behind in terms of like a human development index. Okay, so Africa in a group is doing the bad among all the continents. The next comes a few like a green ones over here. Well, this circle, you see this unfilled circle, this is India. Okay, so from this population chart, if you see these the unfilled circles are the there are two unfilled circles, one right here and one is India. So this one is China and this one is India, the population with the more than like 1 billion people. So there are only two countries right now who have actually the population of over like 1 billion each. So India is almost at the 0.6 of the like a human development index. Okay, and on the parameter of like a ecological footprint, okay, India is still doing much better. We are somewhere close to like a one unit of the ecological footprint on these on this dimension. So that means even with the doing so like a bad, we are still as a country, we are far below causing the negative harm to the planet. So as a country, we are still doing much better. But there are some different kind of issues. The issues are related with the number of population. Since we have actually a huge number of population, so we have a different kind of challenges. Overall, if you see the per person, like purchasing power of like our the citizen of like India, and a per person like GDP, if you see, so that is one of the lowest ones in the world. So even with the doing so fairly, okay, there are a lot of different sets of like challenges in front of like countries like India, because we have to bring a number of people and a huge number of people at par with the people from like other developed countries like Sweden, Norway and USA, which we saw in the previous slide. So they are doing very good in terms of like a human well-being. So somewhere we are lacking in those lines. Okay, let's see the other reflections from this side. So there are countries, okay, from like Asia Pacific, okay, like these green actually circles you can see from here till here. Okay, so this is the range. So the most of the countries, okay, from Asia Pacific, okay, they are still below this actually threshold. Okay, but except like a few here, here and here, and these are actually countries like Japan and all, they are the developed countries from like Asian region. Okay, so they are actually doing much better in like human development index as well as like ecological footprint. So even if they are like they are high on like this x-axis, okay, and they are high in the y-axis also, so they have already crossed this limit. So the countries which are above actually this dotted line, so all of this group, okay, is the group of the big polluters. Okay, so these are the countries actually mostly who are contributing for the imbalance of this planet, okay, which is topped by, you can see, the country like United States of America, which is topping the list over here. Well, there is one small country also here, right here, which is light green, which belongs to this group. Okay, this group, Middle East and Central Asia. Can you guess which country is this one? This is not very big in population size. Okay, this is in the range of like 5 to 10 million. Okay, but in the terms of like ecological footprint, this is exerting the highest. Well, I'll explain more about it in the coming lectures, but I want to give you the answer to this actually question. This country is Qatar. So Qatar is actually giving a lot of like the biggest like ecological footprint on this planet right now. At the pace at which it is growing and developing, okay, and at the pace at which it is creating like waste and other like degenerating actually elements for the like ecological balance, is the highest among all countries combined. Okay, so even if it is like doing very good in the like a human like a development index, it is somewhere close to 8.5 or 8.4, but in terms of like a ecological footprint, it has reached at the level like 12. India at the level of just 1. So see, there is a 12 times rise in terms of like India to this country in terms of like a global ecological footprint. Okay, so this kind of development, okay, which is going to exert such an and stress on this planet, could be very catastrophic. So such development, which is going to bring the humanity, whether this its citizens, to like such a like a high standard of like living, in turn it is creating such an a havoc kind of situations for the other species, other like citizens of the other countries also. So as a like a contributor to the imbalance, these countries are quite like responsible for like such a mess. And the second one, United States of America, as you may be aware of, in the recent like last 4, 5 or 6 years, America as a country has actually withdrawn from like several international like cooperative like policies, like Paris summit was there and Kyoto actually summit was there. So America as a country has never signed the Kyoto protocols and is pulling out of like a Paris agreement also, which is going to have like a further like a fueling this ecological footprint. Okay, so it means they are going to even top actually this present status, which is somewhere close to line 9.6 or 9.7. So they are going to rise even further on this scale. Well, as a country they may be progressing, but as a country which is responsible for like such a bad state of like a ecological footprint, this is really actually not so good. So other countries and other like forums, other actually platforms are trying hard to convince them to control their emissions, control the rate at which they are consuming the resources, because it is very important to maintain that balance. And America is one of the actually a large size country also, which falls in the range of 100 million to 1 billion. So as a country, they are currently in a very advanced league. Okay, and their actually footprint is also very large in terms of like a number of population and overall like a resource consumption. So they must actually consider the situation which other countries which are in this actually league over here are experiencing, which belong mostly to the third world, which what we call them as the third world, like mostly other African countries, mostly like some Asian and South Asian countries, okay, countries from like Latin America, okay. So they are not doing so good in like a human development index. So how the effort from the other developed countries who are far actually ahead of these countries can help to establish this balance, okay, so that we as a species, why we as a one unit species on this planet can survive altogether. Because at present, even if we are like a divided with the political, politico-administrative like units such as countries, okay, but as a species, this planet or the ecological like imbalances, they are not going to affect us based on our like a country or the citizenship. Okay, they are going to affect anybody and everybody. So how this can be maintained is a big question. And countries which are responsible for these, like if you see this, China has also crossed this threshold over here, and there are several other countries from like this blue group belongs to this Europe and non-European like non-EU countries. So mostly like European countries and non-EU countries, they have also crossed actually this the limit of threshold. So as a group, if you see, mostly like these EU European countries, okay, and these red ones, Latin America and some Caribbean countries, and of course the North American countries. So these actually group is majorly has actually impact on actually this Y dimension actually measure, and they should actually help to establish with the transfer of like a technology. Because in the recent times, in the recent years, several like a clean actually technologies has also like a come into the picture to consume resources, to for like a simple manufacturing, okay, for like a service sector also, like a service sector has evolved like a quite much in the like a recent times. So like for example, like aviation, so aviation also exerts emits a lot of like a carbon footprint. So how this can be minimized? So a collective actually pace of this growth and consideration is actually required in today's times to bring this whole thing to a balanced actually life. So we saw actually with this slide, which I have sourced from the global footprint network. So this data belongs to like a year 2006. Okay, so it talks about like the ratio between the human development and the ecological footprint. So obviously it's not directly proportional. So with this, I would like to bring to an end to this lecture 1 and 2. Thank you, everyone.